seat and we'll get started. Metastatic Breast Cancer Forum. My name is Nancy Lin. I'm a medical oncologist at Dana-Farber and chair of the forum. But I want to give a special credit to my forum co-chairs, Elizabeth Frank, who was our lead patient advocate within breast cancer at Dana-Farber, and to Maggie Merrill, who has been an Embrace coordinator for many years and has co-organized the forum with Liz for the past several years. And Maggie is in the back and is waving, so thank you to both of them. I'd like to acknowledge our funding sources for the Embrace program, including a grant, a collaborative grant from the National Comprehensive Cancer Center and Pfizer, the Breast Cancer Research Foundation, the Fashion Footwear Association of New York, and the PanMass Challenge. Today we have 227 registered participants. And I wanted to just go through some highlights of today's program before I introduce our first speaker. After the welcoming remarks and introductions, we'll split up into breakout sessions, and these will be organized by tumor subtype, estrogen positive, HER2 positive, and triple negative. You'll hear about the latest in treatment and research and clinical trials according to each of these subtypes. We'll then all reconvene back here in the main room for a patient panel led by one of our social workers, Robin Rader, and you'll hear from people who will tell us about their experiences living with metastatic breast cancer. This is one of, I think, for many people, one of the highlights of the day. After that, we'll break for lunch, and for lunch, there'll be a couple of different options. There will be opportunities to have small group discussions over lunch with our faculty and social workers, and then there will also be places that you can meet with each other or on your own with your family to have lunch. After lunch, we'll reconvene for a panel on symptom management. And then Dr. Huma Rana, who is the clinical director of the genetics program at Dana-Farber, will lead us through a discussion about genetic testing, what it means, and what it means for you and your families. We'll then move to breakout sessions again, and these will include a session on liquid biopsies, clinical trials 101. For those of you who want to do something a little different, then there's a yoga and stretch session. And then for those who have not yet had genetic testing, we will be offering genetic testing through a booth, and you'll hear more about this in Dr. Rana's talk. We'll come back here to wrap up, and then afterwards I invite all of you to a reception. We'll have some snacks and refreshments, and in addition there will be several organizations and groups who have resource tables, and you'll be able to pick up some resource tips there. So before we get to the first speaker, I do need to let you know about the evacuation plan. We are currently in the dining pavilion, as shown in blue, and there are two stairwells located in the red circles. When we move into the breakout session, some of them happen in the Yawkey Conference Center, which is right across the way. It's shown in blue on this map, and again, the two stairwells that are shown. Our registration desk will be staffed all day. At every session break, volunteers will guide you to your next session, so don't worry about getting lost. Bathrooms are located just outside of the Yawkey Conference Center and past the elevators. We have note cards in your folders for questions during the sessions, and we'll have people coming up and down the aisles to gather the questions. Our additional resources and the resource tables are located in the Color Art Gallery, which is that direction, and we'll direct you to them at the appropriate times. And just to stress that your feedback is important to us, so please complete the evaluations found in your folder. We look at these very carefully every year, and we've made adjustments to our program and our other offerings based upon your feedback, so we really do take this feedback seriously. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Eric Weiner. Dr. Weiner is currently a professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School, the chief clinical strategy officer for Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, and chief of the Division of Women's Cancers. For his contributions to medicine, he has been honored with the Edward J. Benz Award for Advancing the Careers of Women Faculty, the Gianni Bonadonna Breast Cancer Award, and a Susan G. Komen Brinker Award for Scientific Distinction in Clinical Research. But for all his scientific accomplishments, Dr. Weiner is a clinician at heart. Many thousands of people, including some of you in the audience, are the direct beneficiaries of not only his personal care, but of the care provided to each of you by his many trainees, of which I am one, as well as the care provided by countless oncologists who have listened to his lectures or read his writings. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Weiner.
Nancy warned me that I'd be embarrassed, and I am. I have the task each year, it seems, of standing up here and saying a few words, and I always say to Nancy, what do you want me to say? She says, well, just say something. And I feel like there must be some repetition going on year after year, but I actually do think that I managed to change it up a little bit. I don't have slides. I'm just going to talk. I just have to say that for us at Dana-Farber, and I don't just mean in the breast program, I mean across the entire institute, you all are why we exist. So we have a dual mission, and that mission is about providing the best care we can and conducting research, both laboratory research and clinical research, to move the field forward, because the best care that we can provide is still not good enough, and we know that. We try hard to do everything we can do today, but we are determined to push the envelope for tomorrow. And that's not just true in our breast cancer program, it's true across the institute. And there are some of you here who know us very well because you're patients here and you come here regularly. There are others of you who may know us less well, and that's okay too, and we're happy to help whenever you need our help. I just want to say a few words about progress, and Nancy is going to talk about progress and go into more detail. But I've been doing this now for more decades than I would like to admit, like three. And the treatment that we can provide to women and occasionally men with metastatic breast cancer is so different than it was when I started as a junior faculty member at Duke in 1989. And back then, there were women who had early stage breast cancer and women who had metastatic breast cancer. We knew there was hormonal therapy for some people. We knew there were a limited number of chemotherapy drugs, most of which were pretty horrible, that we could use in basically everyone. But we didn't have the kind of understanding of breast cancer that we do today. We didn't understand that there was this thing called HER2-positive breast cancer. We didn't understand how to take full advantage of, and not that we're taking full advantage yet, but we didn't know how to better use hormonal therapy. And the number of chemotherapy drugs that were available were really just a handful. And I think compared to almost all the drugs today, they were drugs that were laden with side effects and really not very effective. So we've really made a tremendous amount of progress, and that progress hasn't been steady over the past 30 years. It actually didn't really exist for about 15 years. And then suddenly, over the last 15 years, there has been stepwise improvements, and those steps keep coming faster and faster and faster and faster. You're going to hear from Nancy today about a study that's actually being presented today. Let's see, it's 3 o'clock in the afternoon in Europe, so I think the study is already presented. But the first study that will show that immunotherapy, which has been so very successful in many other cancers, actually has a very clear role for a not such small group of women who have metastatic breast cancer, and a very meaningful role, and you'll hear about this from Nancy. And that's just one of the advances we've seen. over the past few years, and it has gotten to the point that when we go to our national meetings, and we go to two or three of them, big meetings a year, it's sort of a shock when there isn't some major finding or two or three. And back 10 years ago, we would go to these meetings and there was nothing new. Now, you can ask, why has that happened? Why suddenly is there all this progress? And it's really because of the research that's been done here and many other places around the country and around the world. And our understanding of breast cancer, our understanding of what makes cancer cells grow and what makes cancer cells not grow, and what in the host, the patient, allows those cancer cells to grow and not grow is something that we have studied systematically, and we're just so much better than we were. Not that there isn't a long, long way to go, but it makes me want to just take a minute and emphasize how important research is. Now, research comes in lots of different shapes and sizes. Some research is research that's done in the laboratory with still test tubes and pipettes and the kind of laboratory experiences that you all had when you were in high school or college or whenever. And some of it is, of course, the result of much, much more sophisticated technology. But without that research, we don't make progress. And the research starts in the laboratory and it moves to the clinic. And ultimately, no new therapies get approved until there's a step, a big clinical trial step, when we test new therapies and determine if, in fact, they're working. And I know that many of you have participated in clinical trials through us or at other centers. And they are very important. They potentially provide each and every patient with a different kind of opportunity. But more than that, when you're participating in a clinical trial, you're not only doing something for yourself, but potentially you're giving a gift to others in the future. And I think sometimes we forget how important that is, although I don't think any of you forget how important that is. So I think, as I look to the future, it's going to keep getting better, but we're still here in the present. And I just want to end with a comment, which is that taking care of women with metastatic breast cancer for a breast cancer doctor is probably the most meaningful thing we do. It's a partnership between a doctor and the other clinicians, the nurses, the social workers, the pharmacists, what have you, and the patient, and the patient's family. And we don't take that lightly at all. It's something that means a great deal to us. We really strive to do our best, and we're not always perfect by any means. But if you think about different ways that we spend our time, and there are 28 of us who do nothing but take care of patients with breast cancer and do breast cancer research here. But if you think about the way we spend our time, probably the purest way we spend our time and the most meaningful is actually taking care of all of you and the many others. So to all of you, I would just say thanks for giving us that experience. And, you know, we hope in the years ahead to eliminate all of you. Not that's probably the wrong thing to say to an audience of women with metastatic breast cancer, but was not meant to be sort of the final solution. We want to eliminate the existence of metastatic breast cancer. So it is important to have a sense of humor in all that one does. I can see that in the globe. Breast cancer doctor says it's time to eliminate all patients. Okay. But we want to eradicate metastatic, we want to eradicate breast cancer. I think it's going to be a long time before we do that. But I do believe that there's going to be a time, not in the very distant future, I don't know whether it's going to be 5 years or 10 years or 15 years, and it's going to be stepwise, when we're going to eliminate death from breast cancer. And that's pretty darn important. So with that, I'm going to turn this back over to Nancy, One last thank you that I have, which is to my unbelievable colleagues here, because I work with the best people anyone could ask to work with, both in the Institute as a whole and more specifically within our breast cancer program, and no one exemplifies that more than Dr. Lin.
Thank you very much. We're going to do a little experiment this morning, and you guys all have clickers, and we have a few questions that we're going to ask you. The way that this works is I'll read out the question, and you will, what's that? Okay. I'll do it this way. Oh, no. Okay. So the way that this works is I'll read out the question, and then there are response items on your clickers. Pick the response that matches most carefully, and then you'll be able to see the results in real time, so we'll project them. So question one is, how many years have you been living with metastatic breast cancer? A is less than 1 year. 2 is 1 to 2 years, C is 3 to 4 years, D is 5 years or more, or E is I'm here supporting a patient. Sorry for the music, it's always interesting what music comes up. It's sort of a random track, I think. Okay, so here we go. So, we will pass more around. If you raise your hand, Maggie will come find you. So it looks like a pretty even split in terms of how long people have been living with metastatic breast cancer. You can see that there is a substantial fraction of patients here who have been living with metastatic breast cancer for more than 3 or more years, which is wonderful to see. And quite a number of you here to support a family member. Okay, question two, where do you live? A, Greater Boston and the Boston suburbs, B, outside of Boston but in Massachusetts, C, in other states in New England, D, outside of New England, and E, outside of the United States. Sorry, I'll duck so you can see. Okay, so it looks like about a third of you are from Greater Boston and the Boston suburbs, about a third are from somewhere in Massachusetts, about a quarter are from other states in New England, and about 12% are from outside of New England. Okay, this is the last of the series of questions. We'll do another series before the one of the panels later on. How many years have you attended the Metastatic Breast Cancer Forum? A, this is my first year, B is my second year, C, this is my third year, D is this is my fourth year, and E is more than 5 years. Okay, so for about two-thirds, this is your first year. For about a quarter, this is your second year, and there's a small group of people who've been here now for more than 5 years. All right, so we'll move into the remarks. Okay, how do I switch over to, okay. Let's see if it switches. Okay, great. So what I wanted to do today is to get a little bit in the weeds as far as this big picture that you've heard from Dr. Weiner and give you a sense of what metastatic breast cancer looked like, what it looks like now, and what we hope the future will bring. And I'll weave into this some of the clinical trials that we're most excited about today. In the second half of my remarks, I'll discuss the EMBRACE program, which is sponsoring today's event, including the clinical program, some of the highlights from the research study, and what you've helped to accomplish. So what is metastatic breast cancer? And the Textbook definition is breast cancer that has spread to areas of the body outside of the breast and the nearby lymph nodes. So cancer that has gone to the lung or the liver or the bone, for example. And what are the current goals of treatment? Well, we hope that our treatments will shrink or stabilize your tumors, to relieve symptoms caused by cancer, to maintain or improve quality of life, and to extend survival. So where were we, where are we now, and what would we like the future to look like? So let's go back to 1995. Feels like it wasn't so long ago, although it was at least point more than 20 years ago, it's hard to believe. No one I knew had a cell phone, that's because this is the picture shows what cell phones looked like at that time. There was actually no such thing as Google, so if you wanted to find something in the internet, imagine that you couldn't, there's no search engine. It was founded 3 years later. Amazon was just founded in 1994. In 1995, they had their sort of official launch on the internet, and you basically could buy books from Amazon. DVDs were just introduced this year, and before that, we all used VHS tapes. I think most of you probably don't have a VHS player anymore, and like me, have these tapes that you're not really sure what to do with that have performances or other things from back when you're younger. And none of the eyes existed, so there was no iPod or iPad or iPhone or Apple Watch. And so, you know, we think about this time, it doesn't feel like it was that long ago, but the world was really quite different. And I picked this year because this is the year that I started medical school. So it's the first year that I saw people with breast cancer who are not related to me or friends of the family, and that I was looking at breast cancer from the sort of other side. And our understanding of breast cancer was really far behind what it is today. And as I'll show you, the treatments that are available at that time were very different than they are today. And in addition to the anti-cancer treatments, there are many supportive care options we take for granted today that were not available at that time. I'll just show you this list, and it's, I think, pretty astounding when you look at it, which is that none of the drugs on this slide were approved for metastatic breast cancer in August of 1995 when I started medical school. This includes very commonly used drugs, including hormonal therapy, so all of the aromatase inhibitors, Arimidex, Femara, Aromacin, the SERD called Faslodex. We didn't have any HER2 therapy. There was no such thing as Herceptin or Perjeta or Lapatinib or T-DM1. In terms of chemotherapy, you know, the most basic of building blocks that we use for treatment of cancer, again, all of the drugs that are listed did not exist for breast cancer. And then this whole new set of targeted therapies that we think of that target specific vulnerabilities in the cancer, including Afinitor, or the CDK4 inhibitors like Ibrance or Verzenio, or the PARP inhibitors like Olaparib or Talazoparib, none of these existed at that time. My guess is that almost everybody in the audience has received one of these drugs at some point in time, and none of these existed in 1995. In addition to these anti-cancer treatments, we also did not know that we could use medicines to protect people's bones when they had metastatic breast cancer. We had some anti-nausea medicines, but a lot of them did not exist. So imagine getting chemotherapy without getting anti-nausea medicines. We didn't have a lot of growth factors. We had a few. And then there are a lot of medicines that we use quite commonly to support patient symptoms, for example, antidepressants. And there were a few antidepressants that were available, but some of the more commonly used ones today were not available. If we look at what happened in the 1990s, I think the big news was that there was the development of the so-called aromatase inhibitors, medicines that we use to treat hormone receptor-positive breast cancer. And the other big news was the development of trastuzumab, or Herceptin. So as recently as 1996, there were less than 1,000 women in the entire world who received Herceptin, and it was not improved until 1998. Some of the commonly used chemotherapies that we use, such as capecitabine or Zolotin, oral chemotherapy regimen, again, not approved until 1998. But what has really changed over the last few years is that the types of medicines, the range of medicines, has really expanded. So not only are we looking at new approvals for chemotherapy, which is still very important in terms of what we use to treat patients, but we have seen the approvals of more HER2-targeted therapies, We've seen the approval of a whole new class of medicines called the CDK4 inhibitors. Again, Ibrance or Kisqali or Verzenio are members of that group. We've seen other new types of targets, such as Afinitor for the target mTOR, and two medicines that target PARP. And what I hope you can see is that the pace of progress has really accelerated in these last 20 years. So where are we now? We think about breast cancer very much in terms of breast cancer subtype. We divide breast cancer into three main subtypes, estrogen positive, HER2 positive, and triple negative. But even within these subtypes, we're now understanding there's sort of subtypes within subtypes. And your doctors use the breast cancer subtype to really help us understand what are the treatments most likely to be effective. And clinical trials more and more, instead of enrolling anyone with any kind of cancer, which is how they used to be, are often very focused on a specific type of breast cancer. This is kind of the distribution of breast cancer subtypes in the United States. And what we see is that most people with breast cancer have estrogen receptor positive breast cancer. About 15% have HER2 positive breast cancer, and about 10 to 15% have triple negative breast cancer. How do we treat metastatic breast cancer today? Well, for patients who have hormone receptor positive breast cancer, we typically give hormonal therapy first in most cases, sometimes with additional targeted medicines like CDK inhibitors or mTOR inhibitors. Eventually, we usually do move on to chemotherapy. For triple negative breast cancer, the paradigm has been to give one chemotherapy after another, but as I'll show you, that is rapidly changing. And for HER2 positive breast cancer, we have now many different HER2 targeted medicines, not only Herceptin, but quite a number of more that are available now, and as I'll show you, some that are likely to be available very soon. So we have a better understanding of breast cancer subtypes. As I hope I've shown you, we have many more treatments available than we had even 20 years ago. And we have, I think, hopefully been able to pay more attention to quality of life, symptom management, mental health, and have more options to help enhance these. And at the end of the day, what we see is that this has resulted in longer and better survival. But as you heard from Dr. Weiner, of course, we still are not satisfied, because we know that we need to do better. We need better treatments with fewer side effects. We need a better ability to match the right treatment to the right patient from the get-go. And we want to do this because we want to minimize or eliminate death from metastatic breast cancer. And maybe one day we might even try to aim to cure metastatic breast cancer. So I wanted to talk a little bit about the importance of clinical trials. And clinical trials test new approaches. Sometimes they're totally new drugs. Sometimes they're old drugs given in combination. Or sometimes they're old drugs using them in a different way. And all the treatments that we use today, all the treatments I've shown you on these previous slides, are the result of information gained from patient volunteers in clinical trials. Of course, not all the trials are successful, and some drugs don't make it. And when patients volunteer for trials, we don't always know how the drug is going to turn out. So I think we all owe a debt of gratitude to the volunteers in all of the clinical trials to date. What I wanted to do is to highlight a few of some of the most exciting compounds that we think will be probably at some point available to patients more broadly. And you'll hear more about these in detail in each of the breakout sessions, but I wanted to just show a few of them here, because we think they're really showing the future of breast cancer treatment. The first is a medicine which is called DS8201A. The long name is trastuzumab deruxtecan, so neither of these are very catchy. But the way that this medicine works is that what you see is the Y shape is an antibody. It's basically Herceptin. So what that does is, just like antibodies find their way to bacteria in your body, we can actually create antibodies that find its way to the HER2 protein. And when patients' cancers are HER2 positive, it means there's a lot of copies of that protein on the surface of the cancer cell. What chemists have done is attach chemotherapy to this antibody. And so what happens is the antibody actually finds its way to the HER2 protein that's sitting on the surface of the cancer cell, and delivers high doses of chemotherapy to the cancer cell itself. So rather than delivering high doses of chemotherapy to the patient, which we don't want to do, the patient effectively sees low doses of chemo, but the tumor sees high doses of chemo. That's the idea. In the phase one trial that was reported at the San Antonio meeting last year, what was reported is that in HER2-positive patients, many of whom received 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 previous chemotherapies for their breast cancer, the cancer got worse through each one of those, that over half of patients experienced significant tumor shrinkage, and about 90% of people had some degree of tumor control. So that was pretty amazing, and this drug is currently in a phase 3 trial here at Dana-Farber and worldwide. Interestingly, for those who have HER2-negative breast cancer, we call it HER2-negative because it doesn't reach the highest level of HER2. We score HER2 cancers on a scale of 0, 1, 2, or 3. For cancers that scores a 3, we consider them HER2-positive. Zeros and ones, we consider HER2-negatives. And most 2s turn out on additional testing to be HER2-negative. But those HER2 1 or 2 plus positive cancers have actually a lot of copies of HER2 on the surface of their cancer cells. And so this drug was also tested in patients with what we normally call HER2 negative breast cancer, but which we're now calling HER2 low positive breast cancer, meaning there's a little bit on the surface of the cancer cell. And remarkably, the same drug seems to have similar activity. More than 50% of people with significant tumor shrinkage, even if they have what we classically would consider HER2-negative breast cancer. So again, this compound is coming to phase 3 trials in patients with so-called HER2-low breast cancer, and we hope in the next few months to open that trial. What about triple-negative breast cancer? So the same technology has been used to, the same idea has been used in a lot of different ways. If you find a marker that shows up on a cancer cell more than it shows up on a normal cell, you can make an antibody that finds that marker, you can attach chemo to it, and you can get the chemo to the cancer. So this is a drug called IMMU-132. And what this plot shows, every bar is one patient enrolled on the trial. And what you see is that for the patients where the bars go below the horizontal line, that's the amount of tumor shrinkage that they experienced on the trial. So you can see the majority of patients had some degree of tumor shrinkage, and about a third of patients had substantial tumor shrinkage, including some people whose tumor shrunk to the point we couldn't see them on scans. Again, this is a drug that was initially tested in patients who's already received at least 2 previous chemotherapies. So there is a phase 3 trial going on now testing this compound in triple-negative breast cancer. And just like I showed you with the other compound, it turns out that this drug doesn't only work in triple-negative breast cancer. It looks like it may have similar activity in estrogen receptor-positive breast cancer. And there's a phase 3 trial that's being planned now. It's not open yet, but we hope sometime in 2019 it will open. The big news for triple-negative breast cancer is with immunotherapy. There are many different drugs out there, but the trial that is literally being presented probably as I speak in Munich, Germany, I looked up the presentation. It's supposed to be presented sometime between 3 and 4 o'clock in Germany, and I think it's a 6-hour time change. So I'm not allowed to show you the actual slides, so it's been presented for real, but I'll just tell you the highlight. So this trial basically looked at people with metastatic triple-negative breast cancer, and they were randomly assigned to get chemotherapy by itself or chemotherapy plus the immunotherapy. So everybody in the trial received chemotherapy. I just want to point out that although you can see on the bottom it says placebo, that was just for the immunotherapy. Everybody got chemotherapy. But half the people also got immunotherapy. What is immunotherapy? The idea is that in order for the immune system to kill cancer cells, it has to do at least 2 things. It has to recognize the cancer cell, and then it has to do its machinery to kill the cancer cell. In triple-negative breast cancer, if we do biopsies, we see that in a lot of patients, the immune cells are there. They've found their way to the cancer. So the question is, why aren't they killing the cancer? And it turns out the cancer has a way to turn off the switch of the immune system, and so puts it to sleep. And the immune drugs that we're testing basically turn the switch back on, prevent the cancer cell from switching off the immune cell. So the concept here is that chemotherapy would break up the cancer cell, And it's sort of like giving yourself a vaccine. So you've got the chemotherapy breaking up the cancer cell, and immune therapy can then release the immune system to work on the cancer. And we know from data that is publicly available at this point that patients, about 40% of patients in the study who had so-called PD-L1 positive tumors experienced a significant improvement in their survival, the length of their survival, a near doubling of the length of survival with the addition of this drug. So I'm sure it will be in the press. I looked this morning to see, but it's not yet. But I think if we all look tonight on the internet, it will be there, and you can see the results along with the rest of the world. And finally, for estrogen receptor positive breast cancer, although we have a lot of hormonal options, we know that there still is the potential to make the hormonal therapies better. For those of you who have received Faslodex, you know that it's an injection that goes in one in each buttock. There's only so much drug we can deliver this way. We're limited by the amount of dose because it doesn't dissolve very well. What if you made fulvestrant or Faslodex into a pill form, and then you could really dose it higher, and maybe you could make it more effective? And so that's the concept between these oral, what we call SERDs. This is just one example, but there are many examples that I could have chosen. And what you can see, again, each bar represents one patient, that even in patients who've had Faslodex, Ibrance, who might have had mutations in their estrogen receptor, we're seeing significant responses. So we're really interested in this group of medicines. Again, I don't want to say this medicine in particular because there's multiple of these in the same group, and they're showing similar interesting results. And finally, I want to talk about what we call PARP inhibitors. So a small fraction of patients, about 5% of breast cancer patients, have a genetic predisposition to breast cancer that they inherited from their mother or father, and that's conferred by a gene called BRCA1 or gene called BRCA2. And when these patients develop breast cancers, the question is there something we can do that takes advantage of this difference in their breast cancers? Because in patients who inherited a BRCA mutation, the breast cancer is actually different. It's different in the way that it is able to repair DNA. That's what BRCA does. What PARP inhibitors do is they also prevent cancers from repairing DNA properly. And if you take a cancer that already has a problem with DNA repair and you add a drug that makes that problem worse, the idea is that the cancer cell cannot survive. So this concept was tested in a phase 3 trial looking at the medicine called olaparib or Lynparza. It's an oral pill that does not cause hair loss. It can cause some low blood counts, a little bit of mild nausea, usually not more than mild. It's a pill that does not have to be given intravenously. This was compared in a phase 3 trial with our standard IV chemotherapy medicines. And what was seen is that in patients with BRCA-associated breast cancer, that this pill-targeted therapy led to tumor shrinkage in 60% of people compared to less than 30% who received chemotherapy, and that these responses lasted longer than in patients getting traditional chemotherapy. We just saw this year results of a very similar phase 3 trial with a medicine called talazoparib, and I'm happy to tell you that in January of this year, the FDA granted approval to olaparib for BRCA-associated breast cancer, and literally a few days ago just granted approval to the other PARP inhibitor called talazoparib. So how can we do better? And there are some fundamental questions that we still don't have the best answers to. We don't still really understand why cancers become resistant to treatment. What's going on? We also would like to work out better ways so the first go-around, we can match the right treatment to the right patient, because as you know, there is still a lot of trial and error in what we do. We try something, we do a scan, we look to see if it's worked. And we know we can do a better job supporting people living with metastatic breast cancer. We launched the EMBRACE program now in 2010 as a research study, and then launched the clinical program about 2 years ago. Since that time, over 2,000 patients have been enrolled in the research program. And what have all of you contributed? Well, we've done surveys You've completed surveys and feedback, and this has directly led to our forum today, our webcasts, our newsletters, and other supportive materials. As I'll show you, you've provided many thousands of blood samples, and we are now in the process of large-scale efforts to characterize these blood samples that you've provided us. You provided tissue samples, and we're trying to understand with these samples what is going on in the cancer that allows it to get around our common treatments. And we've collected information about the treatments that you've received and how you've done with these treatments, because this is what will allow us to correlate what we learn in the lab with what actually happens in people. What the clinical program does is it supports your doctor so that they're always aware of the trial options that are available to you, research testing results, and to help facilitate your care. For those who come here for second opinions and go back to a local oncologist, we hope that we can improve that communication. We provide supportive care resources with the forum and educational materials, and we support the research efforts. We do this with four coordinators who are shown here and our volunteers here today, so you'll see them directing you to your rooms. And before I close, I wanted to just give you one example of a project that Embrace is very involved in. Dr. Parsons will be talking later today in a breakout session about liquid biopsies. And what are these? So over 1,400 participants in the Embrace study have contributed at least one blood sample to the research study. And to date, we have collected over 5,000 blood samples. Why do we need so many? It's because every patient's different. And if you want to find enough people with the same thing that happened to them, you have to collect a lot of samples. So you can really ask interesting questions. People might be wondering, what is this haystack here? And it's an analogy because what happens is the tumors actually secrete DNA into the bloodstream, and we can test for it in the blood. We can't test for it with our normal tests. If I send it to the lab here for a blood count, we don't get this information. Because our normal blood tests are like looking for a needle in a haystack from an airplane. You're not going to find it. But we now have the technology that we're on the ground, and initially it was manual sorting of that haystack. So that still took a lot of time. But now there are computer programs, essentially complicated math algorithms, to essentially turn the straw of the haystack invisible. And now you can see the needles. And not only can we see the needles, but we actually can figure out what they're made out of. And so in the same way, we can take the blood sample and we can figure out the DNA sequence of the cancer from the blood. And so by doing this, what we hope is that we can learn what is going on in the cancer when it responds and what's going on in the cancer when it gets worse. So this is my final slide, and I just want to leave you with what I hope is a message of hope. We all do this because I think we're eternal optimists, and we hope that the future will be better than it is today, and we feel very strongly that it will be. I hope that I've shown you a little bit about some of the things we're proud of, but also with the acknowledgement that we have so much more ground to cover. And what I hope is that the progress that we've seen in the last 20 years will make that same progress in the next 3 to 5 years and more, that we can really accelerate what we do so it's within the time frame of when you need us to make a difference. So thank you. So we're now going to have 10 minutes of a break, and you'll go out to your breakout sessions. There are three breakout sessions, estrogen receptor positive, that will be led by Dr. Erica Mayer and Dr. Nick Wagley, that will be in this room. Triple negative, which will be led by myself and Dr. Jeff Shapiro in Smith 308-309. HER2 positive, which will be led by Drs. Ian Kropp and Heather Parsons in 306-307. Again, there will be people to help you find your way to these rooms at the back. If you don't know what subtype of breast cancer you have, this is sort of a way to make an educated guess. If you've ever received Herceptin, Perjeta, Kadcyla, or Tykerb, you probably have HER2 positive disease and you would stay here, you would go to Yawkey 306-307. If you have not received any of those drugs, but you have received tamoxifen, Femara, Arimidex, or Aromacin, you probably have estrogen receptor positive disease and you'll stay here. And if you haven't received any of these drugs, you probably have triple-negative breast cancer, and you would go to Smith 308-309. So we'll have everybody break off. Again, the sessions will start at 10, and then after that, we'll reconvene here for the patient panel. Liz Frank, who's is going to gather the clickers.
Yeah. We're going to gather your remote so that they don't get lost. So there's a bunch of us, like with bags, just throw them in, okay? And thank you.
And we'll give them back for the next round, but we're just a little worried they're very easy to lose.